Welcome, everybody, to this Talks at GS session, and I'm really very happy to introduce Tom Brokaw to all of you who don't know him, which is probably very few.
Let's not have a show of hands for those who don't know me.
But everyone who does know him knows he's the special correspondent at NBC News. But for all of us who've grown up with him, that started a career a long time ago, which we want to talk about today, and culminated in anchoring the news for many, many years. But we're here actually today to talk about his new book, which is really a reporter's memoir, is the way I look at it, during a very interesting time in this nation's history, principally around the time of Watergate and the resignation of President Nixon at that time. And it's a very interesting period of time. Still to this day, there's, you know, we think we have every fact on Watergate, and I'm always interested to see something else comes up. I'm also very interested to find out that lots of people don't really still understand what happened. Now, in my case, I felt, and I followed this very carefully, that, you know, once it's all been established and the basic premise, which is the cover-up is almost worse than the crime, that in Washington you never would see anything like this again. That and it all exposed, and the extent of aides acting on behalf of a president would never occur. And then I found that wasn't the case, that memories are pretty short and things live on and on and on and on. And I wanted to start with maybe just sharing your opinion of it, because I remember, I think you describe in the book a very interesting sense, which was, you know, by any measure, it was one of the most bizarre and incomprehensible scandals, political or otherwise. So maybe we could start there and probe that a little bit more.
Well, the quick preface is that when Watergate blew up, you have to stop and remember it came after one of the greatest political victories any president in this country had ever had. Richard Nixon, running for a second term, lost only one state of Massachusetts. It was an extraordinary landslide. But bubbling out of that were these reports about some illegal activity. Before the election itself, the Nixon team had sent burglars into the Democratic Party headquarters at Watergate Hotel because they thought they were going to get some stuff. I think as much as anything, they thought they were going to be embarrassed. They didn't think they were needed to get additional information on McGovern. They were worried about what the effect it was going to have on them. So I was in California at the time, where I was kind of an unusual case. I was a young guy when NBC hired me. I was 26, and they said, we're going to make you a political reporter, but you also have to do the 11 o'clock news every night in Los Angeles. And the 11 o'clock news in those days was different than what you see now. It was like a duplicate of the network news, except we were on the West Coast. And I got to know during that time Bob Haldeman and a number of people who were prominent in the Republican Party. Ron Ziegler, later press secretary, got to know Pat Buchanan. So I was involved in politics. And then NBC said, you've got to come work in New York. I mean, and I kept saying, I got a house on the beach. And so, I don't wear a tie. Why do I want to go to New York? They said, you don't have any choice. You've got to come. So I came in the summer of 1973, and the hearings were already underway, and it was clear that this is a burgeoning scandal of some kind. And the first thing that happened to me is I arrived in Washington, and Spiro Agnew was going to have a news conference because there was a report that he'd been taking bribes. So that's how I got off to a fast start. Nixon, in the meantime, had gone to the country twice that summer and said, I had nothing to do with this. I'll accept responsibility, but it was his primary allies in the administration. There were Bob Haldeman, John Ehrlichman, and John Mitchell, who were off going to jail, so it didn't add up. And then from the beginning of September 1973 to the end of August 1974, it was rock and roll. It was just day in and day out. We were dealing with, what did he know? When did he know it? What did he do? Here is a profound difference. We didn't have social media. We had 30 reporters at the White House, and we'd get briefed in the morning at about 10 o'clock. We'd spend the rest of the day trying to figure out what else was going on. We didn't go on the air until 6:30 at night for the nightly news. So we weren't on all day long with our colleagues saying, well, he's guilty, isn't he? I mean, what do we know? He must be guilty based on what we're doing. There was a kind of pace to it, if you will. And he was, Nixon being a veteran, was playing the part of a president who had been wronged by his staff. But there were all kinds of indications that he knew a hell of a lot about what was going on. And we had to keep piecing that together. It was like a complicated British mystery of some kind about what we were doing. Then he decided the best way to deal with it was to be presidential outside of Washington. So in the course of that year, he went to Russia, he went to the Middle East, he was on every tragedy in America he would show up for, to be empathetic as the President of the United States, weekends in Key Biscayne, and we had to chase after him and try to keep stitching this together. It was pretty much leak-proof, not like now, because he didn't go on the air like Trump does, or he didn't have access to a way of dealing with the public. And he wouldn't have, even if he did, we'd kind of get some hints out of the White House about what he was thinking. But we'd all have to kind of find a way to trace that together. I had a guy who wasn't the brightest bulb in the world, who was in the White House Congressional Relations Office. They have a whole section in the White House in which these guys carry the water to the Capitol Hill and say, this is what we have in mind. We want to make sure that the committee chairman know what's going on. I had one guy who was plugged into all that, and I could get stuff from him about where it was going and what was happening. And then I would know some people on the outer edges of the Nixon White House who were prominent Republicans on the Hill. And like today, most Republicans were with him until it became evident that he was not just guilty, he was guilty as hell. And the language that he was using and the kind of vindictive attitude he had about it. But it took a while, and it was when the tapes finally began to emerge that the Republicans in the spring, it was late into the spring, began to say there may be something to this. And the pace of the impeachment began to pick up at that point. It wasn't like it is today. It wasn't 24/7. The difference is now Republicans are the advance guard for this president. They're out there trashing the witnesses 24/7. They didn't do it in those days. They'd say, well, we need to know more, but they weren't aggressive about it. Barry Goldwater believed that he was probably guilty, but he also would go down and see him. He took him to Arizona for a big rally on his behalf, trying to play the good part. So there was a different climate, different time, different role, and it was really a kind of water torture for the country. A drip at a time, this stuff would come out. And the fight was how much access we would have to the tapes. And it turns out that I had one day a kind of light bulb going off, and I thought, he kept saying, it's executive privilege. I thought, I wonder if executive privilege has application during an impeachment. So I had a really terrific young researcher, and we started calling around very conservative legal minds at Yale Law School, Harvard, and they all said the same thing. They said, executive privilege does not count in an impeachment proceeding. Then you can get what you need, because that's the nature of, it's a trial in effect. So the last question, it turns out, asked of Richard Nixon was at a big rally in Houston, Texas. It was a radio and television news correspondents. The stations from around the country had a big meeting there. And it was primarily, the questions are going to be asked by the locals. Well, the locals were not the most informed group in the world, so they ran out of gas, kind of. And then the moderator called on Dan, rather, ahead of me. And Dan had a variation on what I knew I was going to ask. It was that, how can you say that you can withhold this information from the committee that's going to make a judgment about you? I was up next, and then I said to him, history shows, and the lawyers and the legal minds in the country agree with this, that you can't claim executive privilege in the case of an impeachment. It's just impermissible to do that. This is before the Supreme Court had ruled. And it turns out that I had the question in order, and it was the last question asked of him before it all began to come apart on him. This was in March of that year. But he was able to get away with it and keep a fair amount of his constituency with him until they began to release what they said were redacted tapes. But you could read through the tapes and think, my God, this is not a pastor in his pulpit at the end of the week. I mean, the profanity was all but outspoken there. But we went through the whole summer, and then the Supreme Court ruled in August that he would have to give up the information because it was an impeachment proceeding. And then it was over for him. But in the last two or three days, he was determined to maybe hang on. And I always felt that that was a result of the victory that he had just a year earlier. He couldn't believe that in 1 year he'd gone from having the most overwhelming victory in a presidential election to being a man who was going to be thrown out of office. But the reality was there. They were down to about five people around him. Ron Ziegler was a name that you may have heard. He had begun as a press secretary. He had a chief of staff who had been a three-star general in the Army who was running things for him. And then he had two lawyers who were working for him as well. And that was it. He would stay in the White House and he would write notes to himself until 3 o'clock in the morning. It wasn't anything like what we're going through now, where everything plays out 24/7. There was no Fox News. There was no talk radio to speak of. So it was a completely different environment.
One of the things I learned in this book, even though I know that you had done interviews, or I later knew you had done interviews about it, these folks come to you, the California crowd, as emissaries from Haldeman at that time, to ask you to come to be the press secretary.
Yeah.
And the interesting part of that story is what comes later when Haldeman sees you at some event and basically tells the story that, you know, you made a really smart decision because, you know, I would have sent you to jail.
There was no way in hell that I was going to become Richard Nixon's press secretary. And actually, it was the first term that he asked me to do that. It was not after they got in trouble. The quick description of this is that I was young. I was 26 years old. I was working in California, and I was in the thick of the Reagan campaign and a lot of other stuff that was going on. And Haldeman was watching me. He ran J. Walter Thompson. And modestly, I got off to a fast start in California. It was a big, big market, and I was on the air a lot with good political stuff. And then he joins the Nixon campaign. He'd worked with him before. They go off to Washington, and in the first year, it's very evident that Ron Ziegler is not up to the job. There was a conceit on the part of the California crowd that they could go into Washington and change it. No one knows better than you that you know it's a tough, tough place to just try to walk in and say, we're going to do it our way. Especially in the press corps. The press corps was made up of guys who'd been around a long time, and they knew what they were doing. So Haldeman sends an emissary to me to say, the president would like you to be the press secretary. I almost threw up. I honestly got nauseous. And I went back to the office and said to my boss there, God, they've offered me this job. I don't want to get near it. I told Haldeman I wouldn't do this for a Democrat as well, and I wouldn't have. But you got to get me out of it. But you got to keep it quiet because it'll affect me, my standing. So my boss in New York went down and saw Haldeman and said, look, we have plans for Tom. He's not going to do this. And it held. It was not disclosed. And I went back, became a White House correspondent. And then John says, I was at an event after all this has blown up. I was now the Today Show host in New York, and I was at an event out at Hofstra on Watergate, and I get this big bear hug from behind me, and a familiar voice says, you know how many times I've watched you on the air and thought, boy, I could have sent him to jail. And it was Haldeman who was saying this. And I said, Bob, we don't tell anybody this. I now turn 50, and the camera crew comes, they go around the city and get reactions from people. Camera crew comes back, and their eyes are big as saucers, and they say, you're not going to believe what we've got. And they put the disc in, and there's Richard Nixon standing up against the American flag, you know, with a flag in his lapel, and a real Nixonian moment. He says, I've always believed that Tom Brokaw was a man of very good judgment, very good judgment. Never showed better judgment than when he turned on my offer to be my press secretary. So that's how it came out.
Mm. Well, it's actually to that point of turning down the job, because the interest and the consequences, and this is when you look at the Watergate scandal, you look at a whole series of individuals, very bright people, who took these jobs, and then all of them, one by one, goes to jail, mostly for perjury before the committee. And the question is, even implied in what Haldeman said, oh yeah, if you had been there. Now, having worked in the White House, the thing I've always understood is that when you're around a president and the nature of the office, it's quite a heady experience. And it's, you know, you start to think and everything in supporting the president and so on. And you think you're going to have judgment always of doing the right thing. You think you've got the moral compass. But here, these people had moral compasses. Why do good people do bad things? And this group that came...
It's a great question in American politics. In this situation, however, they'd all come from California. And Ron Ziegler once made a point of saying, there are like 9 of us who are not yet 30 in these big jobs, and they had not been in Washington. No one knows better than your friend here that it's the toughest place in the world to kind of have good judgment that you can stand by, because everybody is out there to, in one form or another, to try to knock you off your pins. I mean, the opposition is after you, and the press corps is there all 24/7. They thought, especially after they won that huge victory, that they could do anything that they wanted to. And that was, it was just hubris. It was just coming in. And Nixon thought he would be protected, I think, by, well, it's hard to say what he thought, because we, you know, later it got pulled out of him saying, I gave him a sword. And he was a guy who was very smart. I mean, he was brainy, but he had this terrible paranoia from the time he was a young man about everybody's out to get me. And he had no grace about him in terms of how he fit in. And so he let that overrun him after he won that huge victory. And then presidents, we've seen this again and again and again, think, I'm the president, I'm living in the White House, I've got command, I can do kind of what I want to do. We have a common friend of Jim Baker, who was Secretary of State, but before that, he was White House Chief of Staff for Ronald Reagan, and then he was a real wise man in Washington. There are very few Jim Bakers in the world, because Baker could understand what was going on, and he could step in and say, no, we're not going to go there. You know, this is, I don't care how much we've won by, you know, I don't care how much praise we're getting, we're going to get trapped if we do this, if we step over the line. These guys just didn't step over the line. They just crashed through the barriers, thinking they'd won one term, they're on their second term, he's been to China, he's dealing with the Soviet Union, they can do whatever they want to do. And obviously, they couldn't. I mean, it was about as clumsy an exercise as you can possibly imagine. Last year, I was in Washington, or in Florida, and I ran into a second-tier Nixon aide, who was really a driver in the campaigns and kind of a gopher guy. But he was devoted to Nixon, and we had a spirited discussion about Nixon's place in history and what went wrong. And then he looked at me and he said, always remember, he was a great man. I said, you can't say he was a great man in the way he behaved, but there was this kind of onset that comes, you know, with people who think that I've got this big job, it's this man who's given me the job, and I'm willing to see through it. It's the hardest thing in Washington, and it's not confined to the Republican Party. It's all the way. Hubris is the greatest, greatest enemy of efficiency in Washington, in my judgment, and good judgment, is that people get to believe that they can do whatever they want to do. They have people opening doors for them, they've got the staff that is there, they wear these special buttons, it means they can walk through, they can have lunch at the White House mess, and pretty soon they think, I'm invulnerable. And only the best of them knew better than that.
You know, in the book, you reference Evan Thomas's book on Nixon. And one of the things that you specifically talk about is what I learned there, which was that the system that Haldeman put in place in the White House was a system of absolute efficiency.
Right.
And by the way, it became a blueprint for every other White House,
yeah.
Well, with the exception of President
right.
Carter and this one, yeah. But, you know, you made the observation, though, that that doesn't keep you from having judgment. And one of the things that I found just being around presidents or any leader for that matter is you have to have sort of, you know, two virtues. One is courage, because you got to be able to pick yourself up when you fall down, and then that job you can fall down a lot. And the other is the one you're speaking about. You have to surround yourself by people who, you know, you basically, you know, are wise, that have experience and are wise, or I suppose we'd call it discernment in the old days. But when you look at those two characteristics, the real part of your thrust of your book is these people just keep falling short of it. Because I think one of the things that reminded me when I went through the book, and while this is from your personal vantage point of going through piece by piece and as your career progressed in association with them, but I found that it was amazing that one by one, somebody's going to jail. One by one, the people surrounding it, in fact, the most immediate people all are involved in essence, the cover-up, and the cover-up becomes more important than anything else.
Yeah, well, that's by the way, that's an important difference between then and now. As you know, the country is deeply, deeply divided about this president. And a few people have gone to jail. But with Nixon, it was not just a few. It was the former attorney general. He was White House chief of staff. He was chief of domestic affairs. It was this extraordinary group of people around him, right tight around him, who were going off to jail. You know, the people who have gone to jail and the people who will go to jail for this president so far didn't have nearly that kind of power. And in those days, his entire first string, with the exception of Buchanan and Ziegler, were going to jail. Think about that. And he would still insist that he was not guilty of it. He should have paid more attention. And the country was willing to sit back and let the process play out. And I want to just say one other thing about the process, especially given what we've been through here in the last week with the impeachment hearings. It was a different approach. They had a Democrat who was the head of the House Judiciary Committee. He brought in a very highly regarded Republican operative who had worked in the Kennedy administration. He was a lawyer from Wisconsin. He'd worked very hard on civil rights. He became chief counsel. So you had a Democrat and a Republican running the Judiciary Committee as they prepared for the impeachment proceedings. And they did it quite methodically about getting it all ready. Pete Rodino was the congressman. And he found himself in a place he'd never expected to be. He was kind of a shy, retiring guy, had a big World War II record. But he was a product of the system. And he actually became physically ill, knowing what he was going to have to do. But he stayed in the hunt. And everybody worked with him. And Bill Cohen was a freshman senator, or congressman from Maine. He was my age at that point. He was 33 or 34. And he came to Washington as a Republican. But when he saw what they were dealing with, and he was on the Judiciary Committee, he raised his hand and said, "This can't stand." And there had people who voted their conscience in those days as opposed to what's going on now. Cohen had real courage because there was a lot of pressure on him from the other Republicans, much senior to him, on the House Judiciary Committee. And he insisted that what we see that appears to be guilt is in fact guilt, and we'll demonstrate that. And I just talked to him recently, and he said, "It was the hardest time of my life. It helped to be from Maine, because you're raised as an independent," but he had vicious letters from Republicans. But he stayed in, and he helped turn some other Republicans who were much more senior to him than he'd been.
Well, why did you decide to write this book?
It wasn't actually my idea. It was John Meacham. A lot of you know who he is. He's a contemporary historian, a close friend of mine, and he works at Random House. And I started in January, February of this past year. I've been writing this kind of morning, noon, and night. And then stuff started coming out of me, things that I remembered. I'm not a great note taker, but I have a kind of an odd photographic memory. I can remember conversations and stories, what rooms look like and so on. So I started pounding away on it. And then I would call a friend or two and say, do you remember this? And he got it right. And that's why I decided that it's worthwhile. So far, the reaction to it has been promising. You know, people are, especially in this environment, are interested in the contrast between then and now.
Well, I just wanted to ask you, because talk about Meacham, who just spoke, gave the eulogy at President Bush, George Herbert Walker Bush's funeral, and you did so at President Ford.
Yeah.
So what is it about the two of you that ended up giving these incredible testimonials to two presidents?
Well, I think it is that you, with Jerry Ford and your friend Jim Baker and I have become very good friends, and others as well, that if you have values that they share, that you find a way, even though you're a reporter and a public servant, to work it out, because you both feel a calling. You know, one to public service, the other one to journalism. And journalism is not a game. It's also an important part of what makes this country work, that people have access to what is going on, and they end up trusting you as a reporter to tell them, you know, the best you can about what's going on and what's in their interest. I've been offered twice, apart from the Ron Ziegler job, twice, very senior positions in administrations. It's just not what I want to do. I just love being a reporter. I just think it's an honorable profession. I like the unpredictability of it and the kind of ability to, I was just talking the other day, I just got back from Berlin, and I was there the night the wall came down. But the beginning of the story is that it was a Monday in New York, and we had a smart foreign editor who came to me and he said, you know, there's not much going on. Why don't you go to Berlin and see what happens? Literally. There were things that were starting to spill out of the country and so on. So I jumped on a plane, went to Berlin, and then on the next day, there was not much happening. So I was able to go into the East, and that night I reported on the air that there's a lot of unsettled feelings around here, but we don't know where it's going to end up. The next day, same thing, until late in the afternoon, there was a news conference, and a East German official mistakenly announced that the wall was coming down, that they were going to give everybody permission to go out of the wall. Well, if you're in my business, or any business for that matter, it was bingo. We were the only network, including German, that had a live television satellite capacity that night. So I had a worldwide exclusive standing at the wall. This is this god-awful symbol of the division between the East and West was coming down, and it was going to be a new world in 24 hours. And there I was, you know, standing at the wall with all this going on. And there were two things that ran through my mind was, don't screw this thing up. You know, it's going to be there forever. And the other one is I looked down at my jacket. I'm a big outdoorsman, and I had a Patagonia jacket that I'd worn mountain climbing, and I think it really looked terrible. So I turned around, and one of my colleagues had just come from London, where he bought a beautiful new blue top coat, and it was cashmere. I said, give me your jacket right now. So all my pictures, I'm in this beautiful top coat. And then the other thing that happened, just before we went on the air, from the West, students were coming, getting on top of the wall, and yelling at the people on the East side, come on over. And the Easterners, obviously, were worried about getting shot because the guards were around and they were hosing down people. And one guy from the West got up on top of the wall, leather jacket, raised his arms back to the guards. They were hosing him. Nothing could faze him. So I said to one of my colleagues, go get him. I can see him on the cover of Time magazine next week. The new face of the new Germany. My friend came back, he's laughing, and he said, it's not what we think. And I said, what do you mean it's not what we think? He said, he's a drunk. He's been living over in the forest. It's his first shower in 2 weeks.
That's a great story. Oh, boy. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our session. So thank you very much for coming.